Good afternoon. We are here in Amsterdam at the clinical practice meeting, and we had extensive discussion today on the diagnosis and treatment of multiple myeloma with a group of experts. And I'm here with Dr. Antonio Palumbo from Torino, Italy, Dr. Heinz Ludwig from Vienna in Austria, Dr. Philippe Moreau from Nantes in France, and Dr. Mario Baccadoro also from Torino, Italy. And this occasion can be used to review some of the new data that were presented at ESCO in the United States and the recent EHA meeting in Vienna. So I would like to start to discuss three important trials that have been presented at these meetings. And the first one is about the use of proteasome inhibitors, the so-called ENDEAVOR trial. Dr. Palumbo, can you explain what this trial was and what the outcome is?
Well, this was has been an important trial that did show the superiority of carfilzomib over bortezomib. This was a study evaluating a relapse refractory patient in a randomized fashion, comparing the combination of bortezomib and dexamethasone versus carfilzomib and dexamethasone at the dose of 56 milligrams. What the trial is showing is that the progression-free survival is moving from 9 months to 18 months, almost doubling the remission duration that has been achieved by bortezomib, and to some extent is showing the superiority of a second-generation proteasome inhibitor over the first-generation bortezomib.
So just for my understanding, were these refractory patients or relapse patients?
There were early relapse, 1 to 3 prior lines of therapy, and inside this population there was both refractory and relapse patients.
So will this have an impact on clinical practice now or in the near future?
Certainly yes, because we can certainly see that at least at the dose of 56 milligrams, there is a superiority of a second-generation proteasome inhibitor over a first-generation proteasome inhibitor.
Thank you. Two other trials were about the use of monoclonal antibodies in multiple myeloma. One was ELOQUENT-2, a trial with elotuzumab. Dr. Boccadoro, would you like to comment on that trial?
This is a very important trial because it's a phase 3 trial showing the efficacy of a monoclonal antibody in patients that were in relapse or refractory. This is an early treatment because, again, like in the other trial, is patients that were from first to third relapse. And the response rate was really not so different in the two arms because of the monoclonal antibody administration that probably is hidden a little bit the response rate, but the progression-free survival was longer using the antibody. And the author pointed out especially the morphology of these curves because the curve diverge from the beginning and they stay away one of the other also in the last part of the curve. And the author pointed out the different action of this immunotherapy that is able not to give a strong response rate, but is able to maintain as an immunotherapy this response rate for a long period of time.
So there's lots of types of immunotherapy. You have to explain a bit. What is elotuzumab in fact doing?
Elotuzumab, it's a monoclonal antibodies with a dual action. It's stimulating the NK cells and is acting directly on the plasma cells, stimulating the apoptosis of the plasma cell through the to the immune system. So it's really a different mechanism of action in comparison to the other immunotherapy. It's not an active immunotherapy like rituximab that is quite common.
So is
hematology.
It active by itself only, or does it need a partner?
No. By itself only is not active at all, but is active in combination, like in this trial, in combination with lenalidomide in the two arms.
The third important trial that was presented is dealing with daratumumab, another antibody. Dr. Moreau, can you inform us what were the results of and the background of this trial?
We have heard at ASCO, but also at EHA, about the results of the Sirius study. And it's a phase two study studying the monoclonal antibody daratumumab. Daratumumab is an IgG, fully humanized monoclonal antibody targeting CD38 that is almost constantly expressed by the plasma cells. Elotuzumab is targeting SLAMF7, so that's another target on the surface of the plasma cells. And DARA has a single agent activity, and that's also different from what we've heard about elotuzumab. So this population of patients were really advanced ones. The study was performed in US only, and patients were refractory to lenalidomide in almost all cases, refractory to bortezomib in almost all cases, but many of them were also refractory to pomalidomide, the second in-class IMID, and also refractory to carfilzomib for many of them, the second in-class proteasome inhibitor. So we have a population of patients very advanced, and 87% of them were also refractory to alkylators. So in this situation of unmet medical need, and we've heard that on more than 100 patients, 106 patients treated at the dose of 16 milligrams per kg, that DARA was able to induce a 30% response rate. And for patients responding, the duration of response is 8 months. Overall, the progression-free survival, the duration of response is something, the progression-free survival is 4 months. And the overall survival of the whole group is superior to 1 year. It means that DARA is probably a new class of agent, new monoclonal antibody with a single agent activity. And this study probably will lead to the approval of this drug, at least in US. We will see if the European authorities are also accepting DARA as a single agent. But nevertheless, we are here opening a new door, and we are currently testing DARA in combination with many other drugs earlier in the course of the disease, in combination with lenalidomide, in combination with bortezomib for relapse patients.
So when do you think daratumumab will become available in general practice?
Well, we don't know if the European authorities are going to approve DARA based on this phase two serious study. I'm not sure, because in Europe, very often the authorities are asking for a phase three trial in addition with phase two data. But we have, for example, completed for enrollment two important trials, bortezomib dex plus or minus daratumumab, phase three, and also lenalidomide dexamethasone plus or minus daratumumab. And when these trials will be reported and published, I think that DARA will be available. To my opinion, maybe end of 2016 or early 2017. So that's not tomorrow, but it will come soon.
So, Dr. Ludwig, one of the new developments that we discussed is how to define the criteria for multiple myeloma. We have a lot of new techniques to assess the patient, and what's your idea about the recent proposal to change the definition of multiple myeloma?
So that is a major step forward, because nowadays it is recommended to use whole body CT for evaluating skeletal disease. If that is not possible, if you have still conventional radiography and you have a smoldering myeloma patient, you should look with MRI at the spine and at the pelvis, because that's where the lesions are most frequently situated. So if you have defined bone lesions, lytic lesions, and more than one lytic lesion, this is probably a case for early therapy, because when you follow those patients for 2 years, you see that after 2 years, 70 to 80% will progress to active disease. Another high-risk group is the patient group with high free light chain ratio of higher than 100. Again, after 2 years, 70 to 80% will have progressed to active myeloma. And in order to prevent untoward complications of the disease, early start of treatment is recommended by these guidelines. And the third group, which is a very clear group where early treatment is immediately recommended is a group with more than 60% bone marrow plasma cell infiltration, either seen in the aspirate or in the bone marrow biopsy. These patients have an even higher risk to transform, and they should be started on therapy after diagnosis as soon as possible.
Okay, so this includes a new group within the diagnosis of multiple myeloma?
This is a new group of early myelomas, and this is one of the achievements of this recommendation. Also, I personally, of course, recommend to discuss this situation with the patient and to hear his preferences and to show him the data and then to start treatment if the patient agrees.
The importance is that we recognize that some smoldering myeloma patients have early advanced to myeloma and that we can improve their prognosis by
There was some discussion
recognizing them.
Because if you have a risk of 53% to transform into a myeloma, as was shown by Waxman, after 2 years, then you can have you can take different standpoints whether you want to treat those patients immediately.
So, Dr. Boccadoro, you don't agree?
No, but I mean, I think that I totally agree, but this new classification is a step forward because it's including all the new imaging techniques, so like MRI, PET-CC, that were not included in the previous one. So it's not written in the stone. We will change again in 2 years, but certainly it's different than the previous one, and there are several small detail that we have still to define, but it is a step forward that will be really useful for all the myeloma doctor around the world.
Okay, thank you. So if I move to the other important topic that we discussed, is how can we assess the response in patients? What's the best way to do that? And how should we use modern techniques like MRD analysis and so on? Dr. Palumbo.
Well, there is, I believe, a major change in the definition of a response, and specifically we are currently introducing the concept of minimal response disease, MRD, in the evaluation of response after treatment. And this is a more sophisticated, more sensitive way to define residual disease in myeloma. We have basically two techniques. One is the next generation flow based on antibodies reacting against plasma cell antigen. The other one is the next generation sequence based on the definition of specific sequence related to immunoglobulin gene. Those two techniques today seems fairly equivalent. We still need to better standardize this technique to make it available in different labs, in different time points. The next generation sequences is probably more precise time to time. The flow is probably more feasible in several labs. So there are plus and minus in the two techniques, but certainly it's true that we are moving from a definition of a CR that is 10 to minus 2 to a definition of CR with MRD that is 10 to minus 5, even 10 to minus 6. The other major issue is mentioned is that we are moving and we are recognizing that the bone marrow is has, from one say, a patch invasion, and therefore we might have a negative bone marrow with a positive localization of myeloma elsewhere. So it's very important also to introduce the imaging in the definition of response. And from this point of view, we have basically three techniques. One is the low-dose CT scan, probably the best to use at diagnosis. The other one is the whole-body MRI, probably the most sensitive. And the other one is the CT PET scan, probably the best to evaluate residual disease after treatment. So in the future, we will see the introduction of those techniques in the evaluation of response after treatment.
So this is very nice. So we can use more precise response assessments. Does it also lead to treatment decisions?
Not yet, I would say. Today, the definition of MRD negativity is one probably of the best prognostic factors. We are not yet that ready. We need some future study to really use this technique and a major standardization of those techniques to really use those techniques to change therapy.
Well, with all these new drugs, and we as doctors have to make choices for therapy. We cannot give everything at the same time. So we also have to know if our patients are at risk for not responding to a treatment or have an early relapse. So in these days, Dr. Moreau, what would you define as a group of high-risk patients?
Well, we have a number of factors that can predict for the outcome of the patients. At the time of diagnosis, of course, we know perfectly that the international staging system, ISS3, for example, is a high-risk prognostic factor. We know as well that high LDH is another one, cytogenetics, obviously, for 14, 17p. We also can combine these factors in several scores, in fact, to predict if a patient, for example, has a high ISS3 plus high LDH plus post-cytogenetics. We know that the risk of dying from progressive disease is very high. So we are able to segregate and to define some subgroups of patients that will do well or patients that will have a very poor outcome. But we cannot anticipate a very important prognostic factor that is the response of the disease. And that's a sort of dynamic prognostic factor that we are not incorporating into our treatment algorithm right now. Well, and we are on the way of also defining new tools such as genomics, probably, to define patients at a very high risk of progressive disease. So right now, we are not systematically implementing this definition of high risk versus non-high risk, or let's say standard risk patients, into our treatment strategy. Some colleagues are doing in US, we are not doing systematically in Europe, but the goal, in fact, for the future is to try to have specific trials or specific treatment options according to the risk. We have to work on that because we are not ready yet to do like our colleagues in acute leukemia, for example, are doing. They are looking at a prognostic factor, they are finding a mutation, for example, and they are treating according to some initial parameters.
Okay, well, I would like to thank you all for your comments, and also the audience. Thank you very much again.